First thing that comes to my mind is some kid who has a test coming up the next day and hasn't studied enough, so, you know, take some Adderall.
Coffee.
Maybe Ritalin? I'm not too sure.
Right away, I think of the more well-known study drugs like Adderall and Dexedrin a lot.
Well, I guess caffeine is technically a drug, and that one is used a lot.
Coffee's a drug. Cigarettes are a drug. I'm out here having a smoke right now, drinking a cup of coffee.
The stuff in energy drinks? To be honest, I love it.
I think it's not healthy, but I don't think it is injurious.
The line for me personally is where some drugs are sort of more of a slippery slope into the use of other drugs.
It just makes me think better, and without it, I just couldn't imagine being as productive.
So I think, like, if you widen the understanding of drugs, then there's a lot of things that fall into that category.
I mean, everyone takes it on a daily basis, and I think if it was dangerous, it would not be legal, right?
Welcome to the Intuition Podcast, where we go behind the scenes of academia to find out what students really think. My name is Flint.
And I'm Laila.
And today we're asking, what's your fix? Heroin, cocaine, Adderall, cannabis, nicotine, alcohol, taurine, caffeine, and chocolate? What do all these things have in common? Well, for starters, they're all vices that we use to get our way through university. You see, we as humans have a habit of developing habits. And these habits can have a variety of effects which range from mild to extreme. The catch is that while we're very good at identifying the bad habits of others, we're not so good at identifying our own. Even when we do manage to identify our own bad habits, we have a tendency of downplaying them because others may be worse than ours. But does it really matter what other people's vices are when we still have our own? And should we really be judging them just because theirs are different?
I frequently experience overuse of caffeine.
That was Sadeh Tegin.
That's like always happens when I'm dealing with deadlines.
She's a graduate student in the Department of Pathology here at UBC, and she knows her vices.
And I tell myself, I'm actually not helping. I know what I'm doing, but I keep doing it. I don't know why.
We sat down with her to talk about study drugs and other vices, and we first asked her, what is the first thing that comes to her mind when she thinks of study drugs?
For me, growing up in Ethiopia, we have a drug that most college students use, which is called chat. It is leaves, actually. You chew the leaves, and it's supposed to have a stimulating effect. And most people use it for study and concentration purposes. So that's something that comes to mind for me when I think of study drugs. Definitely, chat wasn't an option here. So I assimilated into the culture of Canadian culture or American culture, which is using the 5-hour energy and drinking a lot of coffee. Yeah.
Do you consider things like caffeine to be distinct from other drugs that you could mention? So, for example, the one that you named or Adderall, or do you think of them as the same, just one's legal and one isn't?
Coffee being more socially accepted makes it a bit easier to accept, and it doesn't have psychological... you don't feel bad doing it.
So like psychoactive effects, kind of?
Yeah, and it's things that are predicted that's happening to you, which is like getting jittery or something. But when it comes to study drugs, which are actually prescribed to treat some disorders, it's a bit like taboo. And also we don't know the effect of using them long-term on normal people, how that affects them. So I feel like more relaxed thinking about coffee rather than other types of drugs.
So you spoke about like side effects and stuff like that. Okay, it is true that if you sort of like overuse or misuse things like Adderall and some of the drugs that we mentioned before, there are side effects. But I think it's fair to say that drinking too much caffeine too, and I think Flint sort of like talked about caffeine addiction later on about how they also too have, they have side effects. So for example, if you drink too much caffeine, you can get dehydrated, and that sort of like can mess up all your internal systems. You might have insomnia, and you know, that is obviously an extended sort of like psychological and also physical physiological effect. So where do you draw the line between what's considered okay? Because, you know, health and wellness is sort of a broad overall topic, right? If we don't even take care of ourselves at the most basic level, do you think so it's like fair to say that what you're doing is healthy?
Yeah, you're right. It's funny how we forget about our health when it comes to when we're under stress. We feel like, oh, we just need to get this thing done. No matter the consequences. And that shouldn't be the attitude. We need to always look out for ourselves. Because if I study like 24 hours for 5 days and I don't make it to the exam day, what's the point of all doing all that? So I don't know, for some reason, the culture and also the university environment makes us feel like we don't matter, we just need to perform. So I think that idea pushes people into the direction of taking other supplements or stimulants to perform. So if we can control that culture of like, okay, health comes first, especially in university, first we need to be well in order even to perform or to learn new ideas. So I think that is the first thing. Okay, no matter the season we are in, we need to be able to prioritize ourselves first. And also anything in moderation is what we need to do. Like if we use caffeine appropriately, that can actually aid our performance and also make us feel a bit awake. But if we abuse it, it defeats the purpose of why we're actually taking it in the first place, where we will deal with side effects and then we won't be able to concentrate because we are dealing with jitteriness and anxiousness and other things like dehydration. I'm sure, yeah, the performance would be definitely impacted by the side effect.
You mentioned earlier that coming over here, one of the first things you did was sort of assimilate into the culture of less taboo means of studying more often or more hours and what have you. So would you be comfortable talking about any sort of vices that you may have? Anything from caffeine onwards, right?
Yeah, I think I definitely did this 5-hour energy thing, which didn't turn out well. And also, I frequently experience overuse of caffeine in terms of, for the same reasons, to enhance my performance. That's like always happens when I'm dealing with deadlines. And I tell myself, I'm actually not helping. I know what I'm doing, but I keep doing it. I don't know why. Mm-hmm. But definitely it's just to make me feel like, okay, I don't deserve to sleep. I need to do this. So I will drink coffee even if it makes me jittery and I don't sleep. And then the cycle continues for 5 days, but I feel better about myself because I'm trying my best. Mm-hmm. So I don't know how to break that cycle, but definitely caffeine overuse is one of my challenges and current challenge, I would say.
Are you saying that like you like gain a sense of like accomplishment from seeing like how you have trade-offs with your health and sort of like your work maybe? So you're thinking that like, oh, if I sacrifice my sleep, if I sacrifice my social life, stuff, like a bit of my happiness, I should feel a bit better of myself because it means that I'm pushing myself. Is that the psychology that you are like falling into?
Definitely. I 100%, because especially you know, in terms of deadline and also even in the work environment, you need to look like you're working so hard. And the way you present that is by looking like, oh, you slept 2 hours instead of 8. You know, some cultures that are always going on. I'm always wondering, like, should I be worried that I had 1 hour breakfast and slept 8 hours? It's kind of, I wouldn't share it, or I would be like, oh my gosh, somebody's working hard and I feel like I don't prioritize my work better or something. So that's something I always struggle with. Like when I see around people sleep for 3 hours, and also I see that they're really prioritizing the work to a point I can see physical manifestation of that, and sometimes I definitely feel insecure for not doing that. Actually,
one thing that we noticed kind of coming into here is that when you ask people about their vices, a lot of times they'll differentiate between the severity of their own vice and the severity of others' vices. And so what I mean is that people will come and they'll say, well, I drink coffee, but that's not as bad as other people who do Adderall. And they won't recognize that it doesn't really matter how bad someone else's vice is. You still have your own, right? So do you ever draw the line and say like, hey, well, you know, their vice is worse, or do you have any sort of any response to that?
Yeah, that's something that always I think about whenever I'm going to east side of Vancouver, or I see someone in drugs, in serious drug problem. I always think, oh, okay, I now know better, because the same thing, like if I drink coffee 5 times a day, that's the same thing. The only difference is we chose a different vice, I would say. And it's hard to compare. Yeah, again, with the socially accepted drugs, like with coffee, I feel definitely much better about myself. Oh, I'm drinking coffee, at least I'm not on other drugs. So definitely that part is because of the acceptance of that, the drug of the choice. But there's no difference. Everyone is misusing something. Anything that's not controlled would always end up in bad situation. So definitely it's not a good idea to compare our vice compared to others and try to make ourselves feel better about it.
Yeah, so you're just saying that everyone has a vice, so that'd be a fair conclusion to come to?
Definitely, yeah.
When I got into UBC, I was pretty much a clean-cut kid. I didn't drink, I didn't smoke, I hardly drank too much coffee, I didn't do any study drugs or anything like that, right? I didn't really snack, I worked out 4 hours a day, like I was a healthy person. And every subsequent stressful period that since I've been here, I've developed a new habit, I've generally kicked it, but developed a new habit, which is potentially bad for my health, right? And they vary. So in second year, I briefly smoked cigarettes. And I was in high school, I was the kid writing, you know, public speaking about like cigarettes are gonna kill you. Like, I was like, let's put a ban on cigarettes. Yeah. And then all of a sudden I'm sitting here, and in between my study sessions, I'm puffing away. And, you know, I kicked that really quickly, and I'm embarrassed of it. I'm embarrassed to admit that. But, you know, it's something that I think that you go through so much stress that you start to feel empathy and understand why people get into those habits. And you start to develop them yourself. And it's a really hard thing to go through, because it humbles you. You know what I mean? It makes you realize that like life isn't so simple, that you can, like, there's a reason that people end up in these situations. You know what I'm saying?
I like 100% agree with this, because each time I struggle with something in terms of not being able to control, like at some point even alcohol and things like that, I will judge people less the next time, because I'm no better. Yeah. You know, and struggling with these type of things actually definitely humbles you to a point where, oh, I'm just one cigarette away from ending up like this guy with lung cancer. I think it's good that we all to recognize that we all not perfect, and we just learn from each other and try to do better for next time, I guess.
So I really appreciated today's point about how different people cope with pressures by using different vices. And I think one of the most critical points that she raised was that it's really important for people to sort of like learn from one another. And in that sense, it means that no one is perfect. So we've discussed a lot about managing your time and managing your stress. But one important point that we brought up was that for some students, the reason that they're taking study drugs isn't so much about the fact that they aren't capable of being organized or managing their workload. For some students, it's just due to the fact that they have too much work to do. So for example, if you're taking classes and you have a part-time job and you have other personal obligations, sometimes all of those pressures can take up, and it seems that the only way to cope with all of that workload is really to take study drugs.
Absolutely, and I think that's a really important point to raise, because most often when the issue of study drugs comes up in academic discourse or in dialogues with professors or managers, is often phrased as a sort of a get yourself together problem instead of a pressure problem. And I think the big problem and the thing that forces many students, or at least a good number of them, to seek out study drugs is that they feel so unbelievably pressured by the stresses of the work week. It's the only way they can keep themselves going.
Yeah, then I guess the question of study drugs become more of a cultural problem rather than something that's projected as, you know, a bunch of students trying to hijack the university system or trying to get things done easily.
So it really looks like we're attacking the wrong problem.
Yeah.
And this seems to be a particularly acute problem in North America, because in much of the rest of the advanced industrial world, they're starting to sort of roll back the work week in order to allow for people to have less pressure and more time for themselves. For example, in Sweden, they've instituted a 6-hour workday, and in the Netherlands, they're almost completely at a 4-day work week.
So then we asked today, to what extent does she think that the North American culture is a factor in the widespread consumption of study drugs?
Yeah, definitely. To add to the European lifestyle, you know, they have much longer vacation time too, which is not seen here. And definitely, I think when you're not stressed, when you feel like, okay, I'm going to be at work for 8 to 12 hours a day, you definitely will come with an attitude is like, okay, I have to be here all day. And that already sets the tone for your productivity. Whereas, oh, I need to get these things done and then I'll meet my friends at like 5. Then, you know, when you have that kind of attitude, I feel like there's already a difference in how you perform. And definitely, I think the US and Canada, I think, should adopt something similar to make sure their workers are healthy and happy to be there, and they're not afraid to share their leisurely activities, in work environment, and others would not judge them for being lazy or things like that. I think it will improve the efficiency of schooling or work if we have very set time and a set time of work and a set time for play, and also definitely effective, shorter work week is definitely a good idea. Even in America, like I know when I was living in US, some of my friends, including me for some period of time, I didn't take weekends off at all, 7 days, 5 days of 4 days of schooling all day, 3 days of work. And like Flynn said earlier, or Laila, you said as well, you can't tell these people to manage their time better, because it's impossible to do anything with where you're out 7 days and the performance of everything is mediocre all throughout, at work and at home, at school. And that all comes from the pressure of the environment. And yeah, it's definitely the culture needs to change for the better. At least one day a week where you're guilt-free to just be in your pajamas and watch TV or something like that.
So one of the themes that we have a lot in this show and a lot this summer is empathy. And I think it kind of gets almost annoying to hear that word so many times, because it sounds like some, you know, hippie sort of, you know, life is beautiful kind of, you know, crap,
yeah.
Right? But it's true. And I think that in this kind of cynical perform or nothing world, you start to lose empathy the more that you move through situations. Mm-hmm. And the problem is if you don't develop empathy and you don't go through the situation yourself, or you don't see it, or it's not personally connected to you, you end up in a position where you have a very difficult time understanding why other people got to certain situations, or why maybe you didn't end up in those situations. And so I help run a homeless outreach program, right? And one of the things that my group does is that we, instead of just handing out food, we go and we sit on the streets and we chat with people. And we ask them about their stories, we ask them how they got there, and we use that information however best we can to help improve. And I was chatting with this one gentleman on Christmas Eve. We went out on Christmas Eve and it was freezing. Like, it was terrible, awful night. I was feeling like crap. Like, I was in a bad mood. I was going through hard times, and I didn't want to be out there at the time, but I was sitting there and talking with him. We talked for about an hour and a half, and he brought up, he said, you know, this is my 7th day on the street, and I'm continually shocked and appalled and awed at the way that people perceive me now versus the way they perceived me yesterday. And one of the things he was talking about was how even other people in the street will judge him for his vice. And so what he'll talk about is how his thing is cocaine, right? He had a cocaine problem. And he would say, I have a roommate who does heroin. And he said, he does heroin and he thinks that my vice is bad and his isn't. He looks at me and says, "Oh, you're nuts. You know, you're always, your energy is always too high, you cokehead." And he says, and then I'll turn to him and I'll say, "Oh, well, you're always strung out and so lazy, you heroin addict." And then he says, "But what gets me is these people who walk by the street and they, you know, they look at me like I'm scum because of my vice, cocaine." And I'll say, "Well, don't you go home every night and drink a glass of wine? Or don't you go home every night and smoke a pack a day? You know, don't you do this, that, and the other, right?"
Or overeat, which is a very common thing.
Exactly, yeah. Right? Yeah. And that's a vice in and of itself as well. Yeah. And so the point was that we all got our thing. And a lot of times we don't like to look at our own thing, right? And a lot of times we don't appreciate the way by which people get to having their vice. So if you're born in a neighborhood where cocaine is everywhere, you are far more likely to develop a cocaine habit than if you're born in a cocaine-free neighborhood, right?
Yeah.
And so there's a story behind everyone that, you know, this sounds cheesy because we're all cynical and we're all taught to be cynical because we're in the university, but empathy is the way that we can appreciate people's stories and we can understand them and we can appreciate how we got to and have appreciation for the situation we're in.
Yeah, right? Definitely. I think you can't judge a person who has grown up in less income environment where usually drugs and alcohol and things like that are persistent there and expect the person, okay, you turned out this way, you shouldn't because this is bad. No, that's the environment they grew up in. And definitely we have to understand that, okay, what are the situations that lead this person to where they are now? And how can we help them better in terms of coming out of it? Mm-hmm. And then for people who also grew up in a good environment with healthy habits around them, and then they, by peer pressure or other things, they end up in the same location, how can we relearn the good things that they learned growing up? Mm-hmm. So it's kind of... it comes to a point, okay, we need to really give time to people to explain themselves without judging them. And that's something I don't see often. I feel like sometimes it's like when you talk about your weaknesses or your struggles, it's almost seen as if you're less than or you're less confident person. But we're actually admitting these struggles will help people bond and try to figure things faster. And then also, it's also, we're human. Why are you trying to make me feel bad that I'm admitting that I have these problems? And that's something actually I experience often in my environment and, you know, being in science and things like that. It can be for knowledge as well, not even personal stuff. Like if you end up not knowing something, people will be like, first, give you that look like, oh, you don't know this, and then give you the answer like, why are we doing that? Why you just directly explain to me what's going on? And I think, yeah, in general, we need to be really careful of what we say to people and how we judge them. Yeah.
So I really liked today's response because there was a substantial amount of humility and maturity there. A lot of people think that they always need to put up a front of absolute omnipresence as if they're a sort of God, that they know everything, that they can do everything, that they're the best. And the problem with that is that there's no room for growth if you don't admit any sort of weakness. And it's also an incredibly ineffective way to help people through their problems if you just sit there looking down on them when they admit them. There's no sort of growth mindset when we approach each other as if all we are our problems or all we are our strengths. There's room to change in everyone.
Yeah, and I think part of the problem of sort of like being able to recognize yourself and understanding that where, looking at where your rooms for growth is just to be really, be honest with yourself and sort of like be comfortable with your maybe imperfections, I would say. It can be really hard, I think, for some people due to the pressures that we've mentioned before, with whether that be academic, professional, or personal, to sort of like think and project the idea that, you know, there's nothing wrong with me, I'm flawless, you know, I'm sort of like, and in a way that translates to a being where like you think that you're superior to other people. So I think a first step towards understanding and acknowledging your imperfection is to really to be honest with yourself, knowing who you are, understanding yourself, and knowing, you know, how do you relate to other people around you.
And being comfortable with yourself often gets thrown around as this fluffy, cheesy thing where it's like, oh, my problems don't matter and I'm perfect even though I have them. No, it's not about that. It's about it's about being comfortable enough to admit your problems and work on them. So I guess what I would ask you then, Laila, is what did you learn from this episode?
Yeah, for me, to be honest, when we first came up with this idea of like study drugs and vices, I thought we were just going to go on with the problem and attack and be like, okay, this is why you're doing it. This is how you fix it. But for me, this episode has been particularly special to me just because I feel like we've been taking a big step back with examining sort of like the big questions of study drugs, pressure, culture, you know, social norms and stuff like that. And I've been particularly grateful to the people that we talked to, especially with Sede and also the people on the street that I happened to bump into, for their honesty and also their transparency. And also their transparency in giving their opinions, what they think of study drugs and how did they cope with pressures. Because it's not a really easy thing to, I think, to really step forward and be like, okay, I've experienced of like moments of crisis or moments where I feel like I can't handle things. And I've done things that maybe there are sort of questionable to cope with my stresses. So those were the major takeaways for me in producing this episode. So now I'm going to ask you, Flynn, what about you? What did you learn?
So I think my biggest takeaway is that a lot of the stuff that drives whether or not someone uses study drugs or drugs in general is social pressures. Because oftentimes in my own mind, I framed the usage of study drugs and drugs in general as a personal problem. And I think that's because that's how I framed it for myself and my own usage of vices of various different sorts. So for example, when I started using cigarettes, it was for me, it was I'm weak and I'm making this problem because I'm weak. And I can't control myself and I can't handle myself, but I understand other people who may have succumbed to some form of weakness before. But what I've realized is that a lot of my usage of that came from other people saying, hey, I'm using these, why don't you use these?
I see.
Or even beyond that, what isn't to be used is a social question. Mm-hmm. So for example, a lot of people who end up using cocaine and worse things, cigarettes are bad enough, but worse things than that, use it because they were in an environment where other people said, hey, use these. Or they're looked down upon because of social pressures saying that those are bad. So the law is a big social pressure, right? A lot of people brought up, you know, at the beginning of the episode, we had that one person saying that it can't be bad because it's legal, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And that's how a lot of people frame these things. It's like, if it's illegal, then it must be bad, which is a social phenomenon. Mm-hmm. That's like, there's a lot of things that are illegal that aren't as bad as things that are legal. Alcohol and cigarettes are terrible for you, but they're legal, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the question of legality and social issues is completely distinct from how bad they are for you, but they drive so much of usage.
Yeah, I can totally understand that right now. I think you really made a good point about the social factors being just as important as, or if not more, much more important than the personal factor. And that's one of the big things that sort of like it's really overtaken my conception of what study drugs is and why do people use it and how is it used as an ingredient for, you know, coping devices.
So what's your fix? I think that if we found out anything from this episode, it's that everyone has their own. And the variety of fixes out there is huge, and a lot of people don't even think of them. So if anything, I would encourage listeners to think about what their fix might be and how bad they may be or how good they may be and how they impact their lives, and to just sort of reevaluate how they've perceived their fix relative to others and relative to themselves. And before we head out, we'd just like to acknowledge that we are by no means experts on how to deal with particularly dangerous vices. And if you're one of our listeners who happens to struggle with one, particularly if it pertains to drugs or alcohol abuse, we'd like to refer you to the BC government's website, which we will put a link to down below so that you know where you can find the appropriate crisis resources. We'll also be putting a link to AMS Vice, which is targeted specifically to the UBC population.
And if you'd like to keep the conversation going, we'll have an upcoming blog post on our website, that is learningcommons.ubc.ca. Or you could also reach us at our Twitter and Instagram handles, that is UBC Learn. And with that, we'd like to end this episode by thanking you for tuning in. And we hope that you have a wonderful week.
Thank you.